Welcome to Practice Update. I'm your host, Dr. Aman Shah, and I'm delighted to be here with Dr. Ari Vandewald of the West Cancer Center. Welcome, Ari.
Thank you for having me.
So I wanted to get a sense before we get into the ASCO presentations of how you plan treatment or sequence treatment for melanoma at the West Cancer Center.
So thank you for asking. It's always nice to be able to share what we do at our center. It really kind of depends, of course, on whether the patient has early stage disease or late stage disease. Right now, in early stage disease, the major question becomes, does the patient have a BRAF mutation or do they not have a BRAF mutation? There have been a number of adjuvant studies that have been done in recent years that have shown a benefit to the combination of dabrafenib and trametinib, a BRAF and a MEK inhibitor, in patients with BRAF mutant melanoma with stage 3 disease. And there have been there was another large study with nivolumab as compared to ipilimumab in stage 3B and 3C disease that showed a benefit in disease-free survival, as well as another study looking at pembrolizumab versus placebo that showed a benefit as well. So we actually have a number of different options available in the adjuvant setting. Whether or not we go with a BRAF inhibitor or with immunotherapy remains a topic of some debate. And it's actually quite interesting. In the early days, we used to decide based on whether or not the patient had stage 3 disease, 3A or 3B or 3C. So 3A, we would check to see if they had a BRAF mutation. In 3B and 3C, we would not necessarily check. We would go with nivolumab because nivolumab had the study that included 3B and 3C, but not 3A. And if they were 3A and had a BRAF mutation, we would treat the patient with dabrafenib and trametinib. What we've learned in our experience treating patients is that while the adverse effects of the immunotherapy tend to be lower grade on average, and therefore somewhat more tolerable on average, in the adjuvant setting, those small percentage of patients who develop severe adverse events can be really debilitating for the patient. So autoimmune hepatitis, autoimmune pneumonitis, autoimmune colitis occasionally occur, and it interrupts therapy, and it can take a very long time for patients to recover when they receive immunotherapy. In addition to that, patients who develop endocrine side effects, which are actually quite common in the treatment of with immune therapy, often those side effects are lifelong, and the patients will need to either have replacement thyroid therapy or replacement cortisol therapy for really forever. And that is something that can be dealt with more in the metastatic setting because the patient does not have curable disease, whereas in the adjuvant setting, the patient kind of wants to be able to put this behind them. While dabrafenib trametinib is less well tolerated on paper, the side effects that occur from the combination of dabrafenib trametinib tend to be much more short-lived and are mostly related to high fevers that occur during the course of treatment. And so we actually now mostly leave it up to patients. If they have a BRAF mutation, we will offer them the choice of dabrafenib trametinib or either nivolumab or pembrolizumab based on the data. And we describe it to them that way. We say the side effects are usually more common and a little bit more severe with dabrafenib and trametinib, but they're fixable and they're controllable. Whereas with immunotherapy, the side effects occur less often, but they tend to be much more long-term side effects. And we let the patients decide. In the metastatic setting, the question becomes, again, do you go with immunotherapy versus targeted therapy in the BRAF mutants? In our clinic, we tend to favor immunotherapy over BRAF MEK therapy, even in the BRAF mutant patients. And then the question becomes, if you're going to be giving immunotherapy, do you do single agent therapy with a PD-1 inhibitor, or you do combination therapy with ipilimumab and nivolumab? And in our clinic, it's always a debate. There have been a number of different biomarkers that have been presented over the last few years trying to determine which patients truly benefit from the combination of therapy as opposed to single agent therapy. There's never really been a study that has demonstrated true superiority of the combination versus a single agent PD-1. In fact, there has yet to be a study that has ever demonstrated superiority in any way over a single agent PD-1 when the PD-1 is a control in the control arm. However, there are patients that we do choose to use the combination of ipilimumab and nivolumab in. Those patients tend to usually be younger patients who we think can tolerate the combination a little bit better than sometimes older patients. Patients with rapidly progressive disease who need to have a rapid response because single agent PD-1 seems to not work as quickly as combination therapy. And patients who have a PD-L1 level of 0. There is intriguing data that's not definitive that shows that patients who have positive PD-L1 in their tumors tend to respond reasonably well to single agent PD-1 therapy, whereas those who do not might need an extra boost of the CTLA-4 therapy as well. When we do give ipilimumab and nivolumab right now, we tend to favor the lower dose ipilimumab as per the CheckMate 511 study that was presented at ESMO this past year, which is ipilimumab 1 mg/kg with nivolumab 3 mg/kg, and then followed up after 4 cycles with a standard dose of nivolumab. And so that's pretty much what we do at the current time.
That is very useful. And we're here at ASCO, and I understand there's some studies on markers, on predictive markers, that might help inform your decisions either now or in the future. Could you tell us some of the key findings there?
So there have been a number of different studies that have been presented in the earlier days of ASCO, and Saturday and on Sunday, that have looked at the utility of biomarkers, both in the adjuvant setting as well as in the metastatic setting, that can potentially predict for response to immunotherapy, whether it is in the first line or in later lines of therapy, in the metastatic setting or in the adjuvant setting. And there has also been a study looking at potential cell-free DNA and the prediction of ultimate benefit from targeted therapy in BRAF mutant patients. So one of the studies that was presented on Saturday morning at ASCO was a retrospective analysis of 3 studies that contained immunotherapy. One study was a study of nivolumab as compared to dacarbazine. Another was studies of nivolumab plus ipilimumab as compared to nivolumab as compared to ipilimumab. And another study looking at various different doses of nivolumab and ipilimumab. So these studies looked specifically at the cytokine-related molecules, the IL-6 and the C-reactive protein, or CRP. And what they found was that these were both prognostic factors as well as potentially predictive factors. They were prognostic in that patients who had high levels of IL-6 or high levels of CRP or both tended to do worse no matter which therapy they received. In addition, patients who had high levels of IL-6 or high levels of CRP seemed to not do as well as patients who had low levels in combination therapy as well as in single agent therapy with immunotherapy. So it seems to be somewhat of a differentiator as to whether or not the patients are able to get away with single agent therapy. However, the way the data was presented, we're not comparing the different therapies to one another in the various different arms of the study. They really were just looking at high versus low, as opposed to looking at high immunotherapy of one study versus high immunotherapy of the other study. So we don't have cross trial comparisons necessarily that tell us that it would be better to just do single agent PD-1 versus combination, but it would be interesting to see those analyses as well. In the cell-free DNA population in dabrafenib and trametinib, which was presented on Saturday afternoon at ASCO, this was a study looking at the large phase 3 study that looked at dabrafenib trametinib versus placebo that showed that dabrafenib and trametinib have an increased disease-free survival and overall survival. And they looked at a subset of those patients where they were able to get cell-free DNA from baseline as well as at various time points throughout the study. And what they found was that almost all patients still had circulating tumor DNA at the time of the beginning of the study after surgery. Among those 90% of patients who still had that, the patients who had a decrease over time in their cell-free DNA tended to have better long-term outcomes than those who did not. So being able to follow the cell-free tumor DNA over time might be an earlier marker that can help us determine whether or not a patient is likely going to progress. And while we're not able to make this determination yet, one could even think about switching in the adjuvant setting if it looks like the patient is not having a response in their circulating tumor DNA.
That sounds very promising. Thank you so much.
Thank you.